Well, God bless you, family. Welcome to Character Church on this Sunday. I know that God has something very special for you. What I want you to do is call your cousin, get your grandma. We are about to get to church. Enjoy this worship, and we'll be right back with a word.
Redemption. salvation is in his blood. Jesus, light of heaven, friend forever, his kingdom come.
And by him we cry, Abba, Father. Romans, the 8th chapter and the 15th verse. 2 weeks ago, I began a teaching entitled God's Love Language, which was inspired by the awesome book written by Gary Chapman, The 5 Love Languages. As we are in the Valentine's Day season, today actually being Valentine's Day on Sunday, I thought it'd be appropriate to not only talk about love, but to talk about how God loves. We all have heard of this book, The 5 Love Languages, and how we sometimes are misinterpreted in how we love and how we want to be loved. But I wonder how often we misinterpret how God loves us and how he wants to be loved by us. We started last week looking at Mark, the 12th chapter, that succinctly states that God wants us to love him with all our heart, all our mind, and all our soul, to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. It's this idea that really our church is built on, that we're called as believers to love him and to love each other. And I think we need to dive a little deeper into that love, to really identify what does loving God look like? Well, what does being in a loving relationship with the creator of the world, with the progenitor of the universe, what does true love with God look like? Some of y'all on this stream know you've had enough issues in your romantic relationships trying to figure that love out. So I'm going to try to help you today to figure out what loving God and being loved by God looks like. I touched it before, but just deal with this intentional repetition. I do not believe that Christianity is initiative. I believe it's responsive. I'll say it one more time. Christianity is not initiative. It's responsive. What does that mean? It's not our job to initiate the relationship with God. It's our responsibility to respond to what he has already initiated. The best way I could think to explain this to you, my wife and I have been married for 5 years. We've worked on at least 2 kids. And here we are after being together 7 years from our first date. And I can remember leading up to our first date, my wife had never called me on the phone. My wife had never sent me a text message. My wife had never shown up to my job with lunch. What happened is I reached out to her with a direct message. I slid into her DMs. I was in her inbox asking her if she would like some time to hang out with me. And here we are 7 years later, 5 years married, about to have 2 children. All the vacations and all the ministry we've done together, all the places that we've traveled, all the experiences, the highs and the lows of life that we've had together can all be traced back to one message. And when you look at the relationship that you have with God, all the ups and downs, all of the highs and the lows, everything that you've been through, it can all be traced back to one message. And that one message is that he loved you enough that while you were yet still a sinner, he sent his son to die on the cross for your sins. That is how much God loves you. Everything you've gone through, everything you've been through as a believer, it all points back to that message that our God loves you. Please excuse the intentional repetition, but Christianity is not initiative. It's responsive. We are responding to the fact that God has loved us. And as we tiptoe towards our text today, I want you to look at Romans, the 8th chapter, starting at the 14th verse. Romans, the 8th chapter and the 14th verse. And it reads like this. For all who are being led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons and daughters of God. okay, I can't rush past this, y'all. I have to spend some time here to make sure we're all on the same page. If I was in person at church, I would shout out to Nate. It's time to give them some context so they can respect the content. We have the book of Romans, which is written by the Apostle Paul to the churches in Rome. There are believed to be at least 5 churches in Rome, and most of the people who were a part of those churches were called Gentiles, meaning they were not Jewish or born Jews. These were men and women who were born as Gentiles. So by birthright, they were not believed to be connected or in the family of God or chosen by God. By birthright, they were outsiders. By birthright, they were excluded. And that's until Jesus showed up. So now that Jesus has come, died on the cross for our sins, and rose again on the third day, Paul is writing a letter to these people who were previously seen as outsiders, who were previously seen as people who could not be embraced by God. And what does he tell them? He says, "For all who are led by the Spirit, those are the children of God." He is not saying if you are born or connected to a certain family, then you're a child of God. He's not saying if you dress a certain way or eat a certain way or talk a certain way, you are a child of God. What he literally says is if you are led by the Spirit, if you are led by his Spirit, then you are a child of God. This was a shift from thousands of years of thinking. This was a shift from what the relationship with God previously looked like into what it looks like right now. Now, no longer was it about who your birth mother or father was. This was a spiritual thing. Paul says in Romans, the 8th chapter, if you are led by God's Spirit, then you are a son and a daughter or a daughter of God. I want to take this text from antiquity to modernity. I want to take this text from the church at Rome to the church at Character. And I want to encourage you and let you know you are a child of God. If you are led by his Spirit, you are a child of God. This is the question I really want to get off today. What does it mean when you embrace the fact that God sees you as his child? Well, what does it mean that God, I'm asking you personally, what does it mean to you that God sees you as his child? Because we all know what it is to be a child. We all know, I like this little saying, all we know is what we know. All we know is what we know. And many of us, our experience with our parents was not always the best. Many of us, somewhere along the line, maybe our parent died while they were still young. Maybe our parent was not as present as we wish they were. Maybe we had a parent who was crazy. Many of us deal with some of our daddy's demons and our mama's mess. And truth be told, I said it, all we know is all we know. So what does it mean to us when scripture says we are God's children, when all we know as children is the dysfunction of our parents? What does it mean to say I'm his son? What does it mean to say I'm his daughter when my mother or my father did me dirty? What does that mean? Well, before we can get there, first, I need you to embrace the fact that you truly are a child of God. John, the first chapter, starting at the 12th verse, it says, "Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or of a husband's will, but children born of God." This is heavy because the scripture is making it clear that everybody is not a child of God. Now, not everybody walking this earth is a child of God. The scripture says to those who believed, those are the children of God. I need you to know today, if you believe in him, you have the right to call him father, and he calls you son. He calls you daughter. If you believe in him, God sent me here today to communicate to you, he is your father, the God who loves deeply, the God who cares, the God who encourages and empowers, the God who gives peace in the midst of struggle. That God is your father. Okay, I'm trying to give y'all from the NASB version. We looked at a scripture from the NKJV version. Let me give you the LKP version, the Lance Kevin Penland version of this. You all have heard of this movie. It's one of my favorite trilogies. It's the trilogy that is the Taken films. You all may have heard of this movie, Taken, starring Liam Neeson. It's the film Taken. And in this film, there's a young lady who goes abroad. She goes on a trip outside the country. And her father finds out that while she was out of the country, she ends up being kidnapped by some villainous people. The father gets the kidnappers on the phone and he says, "You don't know who you kidnapped. That's my daughter." And because I'm a cold brother, he's on the phone. He says, "I will find you and I will kill you." The rest of the film, Liam Neeson tracks down the men who kidnapped his daughter. He fights them until he gets his daughter back into the safety of his arms. Some of y'all are looking and saying, "Pastor Lance, what does Taken have to do with me? What does Liam Neeson and his daughter being kidnapped have to do with me and God being my father?" Well, this is what I want you to know. The God who is our Father in heaven, the God who sits high and looks low, that God cares about you. He cares about you to the point that whoever comes against you, he'll do whatever it takes to save you. He'll do whatever it takes to bring you back. He'll do whatever it takes to keep you. That God is your Father. Y'all thought Liam Neeson was a good dad, but watch how good God the Father in heaven is to you when the enemy attacks you, if you believe. God wants to rescue you. He wants to strengthen you. He wants to build you up because he is your Father. Somebody embrace the fact that God, the progenitor of the universe, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last, the one who knows the end from the beginning, is your Father. Romans, the 8th chapter and the 15th verse, it reads like this: "For you have not received a spirit of slavery. You have not received a spirit of negativity. You have not received the spirit that you experienced when you were with your earthly parents, leading to fear again. But you have received a spirit of adoption as sons and daughters, by which we cry out, Abba, Father." Paul is bringing to mind in this scripture some of the things that Israel had been through in their past. They had been through Egyptian bondage and slavery. They had been through Babylonian bondage and slavery. And he was saying, when you come into relationship with God in this season, when you believe in God in the new covenant, God is not going to lead you into some negative experience that you had already been through in your past. God is going to lead you into freedom. God is going to lead you into joy. God is going to lead you into strength, because that is the type of Father that he is. But when I think about God being a father, truthfully, I think about Jesus before he went onto the cross. He was in the Garden of Gethsemane. You can read it, I believe, in Mark, the 12th to 13th chapter. And he was praying to God and he said, "Abba, Father, I need you." He said, "Abba, Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass, but not my will, but your will." What's interesting about this text in Mark is Jesus does not go to God in heaven and just say, "Dad, I need you." What he literally says to him is, "Abba, Father." That word Abba is a Jewish term that was truly a sense of endearment. It meant that we have some depth to our relationship. I know that you love me and you know that I love you. I can look back over my life and see that you've been there for me. I'm calling on you not just as my mother's sperm donor. I'm calling on you as a father who loves his son. He said, "Abba, for Father, I need you." He was calling on his father whom he knew loved him. This is what Paul was saying to the Gentiles. And this is what I'm saying to you today. God is not just saying, "I'm your daddy." God is saying literally, "I am your Abba Father. I am the one who loves you and cares for you deeply. There is passion in the love that I feel for you. I am concerned about you. When you believe in me, you are adopted or engrafted into the family as a child. This is what God is saying. And I'm not just any old type of father. I am Abba, your father. Now, not only was this what Paul was saying to those Gentiles in the Roman church, but this was also a declaration to the few Jews who are also a part of the church in Rome, because those Jews understood what Abba meant. So as he was communicating to the Gentiles that God loves them, he was also announcing to the Jews that no longer will there be a separation from how God treats you and how God treats them. God is fully embracing them, even with the craziness that they come from, as their Abba Father. I have to tell you, recently I took what's called a genealogram, which is where you look back at your family history and see who your father and mother were. You see who your grandparents were. You look at your siblings. You look at your auntie and uncle. And as you take the genealogram, you begin to connect dots on the relationships between your mother and your father. You connect the dots between your grandmother and your grandfather. You connect the dots between your aunts and uncles and your parents, and then you connect the dots between yourself, your sibling, your spouse, and your children. And what the genealogram exposes is the issues that you had oftentimes show up in the life of your parents. The issues that you have often show up in the life of your grandparents. The issues that you have often show up in the life of your children, unless God comes in and changes things. And what I lifted as I was looking from that is that I, like many of you, come from a family that has experienced dysfunction in many different places. I saw some of the issues my father had with his sibling, with some of the very issues I was having with mine. And I had to be broken before God and say, Lord, help me to heal in these areas so the problems of my father, the problems I've experienced, do not become the problems of my son. And I looked at my family and all the issues that we had, and God began to speak to me and say, yes, you may have issues in your natural family, but I am engrafting you in to this spiritual family, and my love will make you whole. My love will fix every broken area in your mind. My love will heal every hurting place in your heart. And many of you are watching this and you have experiences just like me, where there may be issues and problems from your past. There may be things that grandmama and mama dealt with, but God is saying, I am your new father. I am your Abba. And because you believe in me, I'm setting you free from all the bondage the enemy has tried to attach to your family. I want to tell you all, I almost called this sermon, Mama's Baby, Daddy's Maybe. And the reason I almost called it that, you all have heard that ghetto phrase. And what that phrase means is that mama oftentimes is going to do everything she can to provide for her baby. But truth be told, there are some men, not all men, but there are some men who don't step up to the plate and do what their children need them to do as a father. It seems like the mom is going to be consistent and committed to her kids, but for some odd reason, oftentimes daddy is just not there. And I want to encourage you with this. God is not the type of father who treats you like a choice. God is not the type of father who treats you like an option. The scripture says he will never leave you nor forsake you. God is with you at the mountaintop, and God will be with you at the valley low. That is the type of father that he is. We gotta go, but Romans, the 8th chapter and the 16th verse, it says the Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are the children of God. The Spirit of God testifies by way of your spirit that you are his child. The scripture is literally saying the proof that God is your father can be found in you. You all know I have one son named Lance Kevin Penland II. He's my namesake. And I have another son who's baking in the oven. He's on the way. My wife is about 6 months pregnant as we're recording this. And it's funny because there are often things I don't notice about myself that I'll see my son doing. And I don't realize that the characteristic that my son has is actually a characteristic that was passed down from me. And we'll go outside the house and we'll find ourselves in a place around somebody that knows me very closely. And they look at my son and say, oh my gosh, he does that just like his daddy. That they'll look at him and they'll look at me. And then they look at me and they look at him and they say, Lance, have you ever noticed he does that just like you? And I say, you know what? I've seen that my son did that, but I never noticed that was something that I did. And what they're literally saying to me, I can tell that's your son because the very thing you do, he finds himself doing. Y'all are not hearing me on today. That these people are saying it's natural to him because he's your father. Because he's your father, because Lance, that's your son. Your son takes on the characteristics of you, his father. There are some things that are going to show up in your life. That there are some characteristics that are going to show up in your life. There's some favor that's about to hit your life. I'm talking to you watching this right now. That there are some things that are going to show up in your life because of who your father in heaven is. Is because God has embraced you as his son, because he's embraced you as his daughter. There are some things that are on God. There are some characteristics that God carries that are about to show up in your life. Let's look at Romans, the 8th chapter and the 17th verse, and we're going home. It says, and if children are heirs also, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him so that we may also be glorified with him. What is this scripture saying? The scripture is saying if you'll believe in him right where you are, with the struggles that you have, with the problems that you have, if you'll trust in him, yes, you're going to go through some struggles, but you will also experience his glory. You are also going to experience his strength. You are also going to experience his peace. You are also going to experience his joy. What God has to offer, the characteristics of God, because you are his son, because you are his daughter, those things that identify God as God will begin to show up in your life. The love of the Lord, the peace of the Lord, the strength of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, because that's your daddy. People will look at you and they say, when I see you, I see your daddy. When I see you, I see his strength. Well, when I see you, I see his peace. God's love language. He loves you as a father. That's how he sees you. He sees you as a father seeing his daughter. He sees you as a father seeing his son. And because that's how he sees you, he's going to give you everything he has if you just believe. Believe in him. This is what Romans, the 8th chapter, the 14th verse tells us. And if you are led by him, you are his child. And you will experience all the benefits that come with being his child. I want to pray with you today that as you begin to embrace the love of God, you embrace it with a clear understanding that he sees you as his son. He sees you as his daughter. Wherever you are, partner with me in prayer. Father, I thank you for this person who tuned in with us. I thank you for this man. I thank you for this woman who you've called, who you have a plan for, who you have a purpose for. And God, with everything they're dealing with everything going on in their life, Lord, I pray that you remind them that you're their father, that you see them as your child. And Lord, you will withhold no good thing from them. Lord, whatever it is that they need, we know you to be a provider. Lord, if it's peace, if it's strength, if it's joy, if it's opportunity, if they're knocking on the door, Lord, I'm praying that you provide them with all that they need according to your will. God, we know that you're a good, good father. We know that you care for us. Lord, you embrace us not as a slave, but as your children. Give us the strength to trust that. Give us the mind to believe that. And Lord, love us, encourage us, strengthen us, and put us in the position so others can see your characteristics in us. Use us, God, and pour us out to impact others. And we thank you for doing it now. Lord, we thank you that you fill us until we overflow. In Jesus' name I pray. Thank God and amen. Listen, God sees you as a child. He sees you as his child. And you may be watching this saying, Pastor Lance, I don't feel like I'm in position for God to see me as his son. I know I'm not in position for him to see me as his daughter. You may be saying, Pastor Lance, I've never truly given my life to him. I've come to church. I've heard the word. I thought I gave myself over, but I'm not where I'm supposed to be. No matter where you find yourself, God is waiting with open arms to embrace you as your father. What I want you to do, I want you to repeat after me. Let's say this prayer together. Say, Lord, I'm a sinner in need of a savior. I believe that you died on the cross and that you rose again on the third day. And when you got up, I got up. I thank you, Lord, for saving me, for taking me out of this and this out of me. And I'll never be the same another day in my life. I am your child. I'm saved. Look at me. If you prayed that prayer with a sincere heart, you are saved. And don't let anyone talk you out of that. And I say it almost every week, but I say it because it's valuable. There's a process to your progress. So you just put one foot in front of the other, take it one day at a time, and watch how God will make the rest of your life the best of your life. I hope you know I love you, my wife loves you, but most importantly, God loves you. He sees you as his son, man. He sees you as his daughter, woman. And he wants you to know, love him back, because he is your father who is in heaven. We're going home. God bless you. I thank you so much for tuning in. I want to remind you that we have prayer on the final Saturday and first Saturday of every month. Prayer in the morning at 9 a.m. I want to encourage you to partake in that. I'm so grateful for Marquita Miles, who leads us in prayer and organizes this. She's such a blessing to our church. And if you haven't signed up to our email list, go to characterchurch.org and just go ahead and click the join tab. We have some great, awesome things happening at the church, even on this month. So sign up so you can partner with us in the various things that we do. I hope you have an awesome faith and favor filled week, and don't let nobody get on your nerves. God bless you.